Leave a legacy. If only it were that simple. Crusader Kings III thrusts players into a historical world, hands them a castle, and says sayonara. Hello friends, it's Codiak here, one half of the team behind Legacy Gaming, and today, I'm sharing everything I wish I knew sooner about Paradox Interactive's grand strategy game, Crusader Kings III. There is a lot to learn when it comes to this game. I mean, an absolute ton. But there are plenty of tips I've learned along the way. If you're anything like me, you've most likely been frustrated by the insane number of pop-ups and tooltips in the game. It's just part of the deal, and there's nothing you can really do about that, but you can control how much real estate they take up. I highly recommend, if you haven't done so already, to go into the settings and reduce the graphic UI. You want it large enough so that you can still read, but small enough that you can see what the hell is actually going on the screen. Once I made this change, that overwhelming sensation completely disappeared and I started to settle in with the game. In that same vein, I highly recommend you set your tooltips to action lock. I spent an absurd amount of time trying to move my mouse over specific key phrases and tooltips, only to have them vanish. Setting up action lock allows you to freeze them once they appear and completely gets rid of that issue. It's a small quality of life change, but it's fantastic. Just trust me on this one. Now that we've got the setting nonsense out of the way, let's dive into the meat and potatoes. And there's nothing I'd rather talk about than the casus belli, or cause for war. My god, did this take me a long time to understand. One of the most primal instincts you'll have while playing this game is to raid and pillage across the land and just scoop up territory left and right. But that's not exactly how it works. You have to pick your way through the map, taking one claim at a time. To really understand casus belli, you need to read the tooltips, 100%. If there's one thing I recommend you read and reread over and over, it's this, because it's such an important concept that it will completely make or break your experience with the game. The simple breakdown is this: you need to have a claim to lands you want to conquer. You do this a number of ways. You can either marry people, marry off people, have vassals with claims, or have your bishop fabricate a claim. It's actually rather simple on paper, but trying to follow the breadcrumbs is a bit harder. When you're choosing who to marry or who to marry your family members to, make sure to take a look and see if they have any rights to claim territories. Ideally, you'll want these to be closer to your capital. The more spread out you are, the harder things are to manage, especially if you're a new player. You can pretty much just use your bishop to fabricate claims given enough time, but whoever's in that role needs to have a favorable opinion of you. Don't forget to sway or send them gifts so that they stay loyal. It's a tough concept, I'll give you that, but it's one of the fundamental pillars of understanding Crusader Kings III. This next bit of advice may not shock a lot of you, but I'm willing to bet there are a number of people out there that have chosen the same lifestyle every playthrough because that's what they're comfortable with. I know I did. Give me a stewardship lifestyle and let me make a lot of money. Yes, please. If you do this, that's fine, but you're actually missing out on a huge chunk of what the game has to offer. By choosing different lifestyles, your leadership experience will drastically change. Pop-ups and quick events are linked to the lifestyle you choose, so you'll be able to see more of the game based on that decision. It's a great way to extend the life of the game and gives you an entirely new way to play. Lifestyles are one of the central RPG elements that make Crusader Kings a blend of multiple genres, and I highly recommend you take advantage of that. Crusader Kings III should have been called the Making Lots of Decisions Simulator, because that's legit all you do. That's the genre. But there are even more decisions that you could be making, but probably aren't. The game's tutorial does a good job getting you up and running, but it just can't cover every aspect of the game. That would take hours, and new players just wouldn't stick around that long. One of the most interesting things the game glosses over is the decisions tab on the right-hand side of the map. These events are largely optional and range in their impact and effect, but rarely pop up on your issues tracker, which is why I think a lot of new players may miss this. Decisions range from hosting a hunt and reducing stress, to founding a new holy order, and it's a really cool menu that I fear players are just missing out on. Major decisions have huge, rippling effects across the world, while smaller events are really just ways for you to keep balance. Decisions add even more depth to an already jam-packed game, so check out the tab and explore it for yourself. Before we mention casus belli, but what happens once you declare said wars? Well, first off, you'll really want to rally your troops. That's a no-brainer. But check out the bottom left hand of your screen for more control over your army. For me, when I declare war, I go all out and pretty much just burn anything and everything I can get my hands on. But there are some useful tools at your disposal, like the ability to split your army in half. This is really useful if you want to take on multiple locations at once, or even use those armies to outmaneuver your enemies. When you declare war, remember, you're fighting over the claim, nothing else. In the bottom right of your screen, you'll see a benchmark of how you're doing, and the worst thing that you can do is drag on a war, because it'll cost you resources you most likely can't afford to lose. The AI in this game are frustrating sometimes, and they'll often run away from a battle. You'll get that urge to chase them around the map and wipe them out, but resist that urge. Focus on the task at hand, taking fortresses and cities and winning the war. One of the fastest ways to win a war is by taking high-value prisoners. You have all the tools at your disposal to find these targets, and when you do, you can use that to your advantage. Keep an eye on that meter on the bottom, and once it hits 100, enforce your demands and claim your prize. Waging war on this scale is really fun, but it does come with some practice and understanding of the rules. But once you get the hang of things, you'll be an absolute terror on the battlefield. I mentioned before that I really enjoy money. I like making it, spending it, but ultimately, it's been my downfall more than I care to admit. Crusader Kings III has the knack for throwing you a curveball at the absolute worst time, like when my army is halfway around the world fighting a holy war and some a-hole decides now would be a good time to try and wage war back at home. You ready for some simple advice? Never spend all your money. Those curveballs I mentioned, those can usually be avoided by hiring some mercenaries, but like all good swords for hire, they don't come cheap. I recommend saving about 300 to 400 gold and never dipping below that. By training yourself to do this, you'll never be in a position of weakness. Sure, you may not outright win the war, but if that's the case, it'll buy yourself time. Hiring mercenaries also allows you to expand your existing army if a stronger force decides to bully you. Seriously, friends, take it from me. I have ruined near-perfect playthroughs because I'm a greedy SOB, so don't make the same mistake as me and really think big picture. By now, you've probably realized that vassals are critical to your success as a leader, but they also contribute to the overall development of your territories. Swaying or seducing vassals is good, but it's not enough to fully understand their contributions to your efforts. Shout out to Italian Spartacus for this tip because I honestly had no idea that vassal contributions ran even deeper. If you go to the realm menu and go to the vassals tab, you'll see a contribution bar at the bottom of each section breaking down how much gold and levies they're contributing. Chances are your vassals are holding back, and the easy way to see why is by hovering over this icon here, which will reveal a situation or circumstance that's preventing vassals from contributing more. This completely shocked me, as I thought good standing and territory control was enough to gain the maximum contributions, but boy, was I wrong. So make sure to check it out on each of your vassals to ensure they're not holding out. I want to end with this one. There is no right way to play Crusader Kings III. It's true. Sure, you can make mistakes and the game can come to an abrupt end, but what you decide to do while you're leading is entirely up to you. Set firm objectives in your head, but be ready to change those if you see opportunities arise. If you want something a bit more structured, feel free to play one of the pre-made scenarios and try out the variations throughout history. Each setup is different and gives you control over different parts of the world. You're not going to get it right the first, second, or even third time, but you will get better and start to grasp more of the fundamentals, and that's really the beauty of the game. So go ahead and leave your legacy, whatever that means to you. Friends, I cannot tell you how much fun I'm having with this game. Maybe I'm still in the honeymoon phase because this is my first real grand strategy game, but Crusader Kings III is an absolute blast. I could go on for 20 more minutes about why this game is good, but if you're watching this video, you probably already know that. If you did enjoy our content, please consider liking the video and subscribing to Legacy Gaming. Livid and myself work day and night to bring you all great content, so hit those buttons below and support the channel. Also, if you're interested in joining our community, check out the link to the Discord below. We're closing in on 6,000 members, so join today and become part of the family. My name is Codiak, and from everyone here at Legacy Gaming, thanks for watching, and play on.